It's modern. It's contemporary. Jesus said, listen, you have granted him, Jesus, the Word made flesh, authority over all people so that he can give eternal life to all those you've given him. Now, this is eternal life. What's eternal life? That they know you. Eternal life is an intimate knowledge of God. That's what eternal life is. And it starts now. And it continues on through the grave, on into eternity. This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God. The only true God. Because as I've already stated, people have all kind of gods. But there's only one true God. And Jesus Christ, whom you have sent, I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. King James says, I have made your name known to these you have given me. Because those who have that intimate relationship with Jesus and have that walk with Jesus have the name of God revealed to them in that they know God as these different facets of his character and of his personality. So they learn that God is a provider. They learn that God does all of these things. How do they learn it? They learn it as they walk with Jesus, and Jesus reveals these aspects of God's self to them. But they have to be willing to walk with Jesus. I have to read one more verse, and then I'll really be done. Philippians. That's one of those ones I don't read a whole lot. I love this one. Philippians chapter 2. And it says this. Let this mind. Philippians chapter 2 verse 5. Let this mind. Somebody say, what mind? Let this mind. Let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Now, let me stop here for a minute. Let this mind, let this attitude, let this mindset be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So in other words, he's saying you ought to have the mind of Christ. You ought to think just like Jesus. How many of y'all think like Jesus? Let this mind be in you, who, being in very nature God, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but he made himself of no reputation. Taking the very nature of a servant, being made in the likeness of humanity, and then being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to death, even the death on the cross. Let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus was God who became a man who humbled himself to the will of God for the purpose of God to the point he was willing to go in the grave through the cross. Why? To accomplish the purpose of God. Now, if that's how Jesus was, what makes us think we're going to get away with anything less? If God wouldn't change his plan for Jesus, what makes you think he's going to change it for you? That's just a question. Jesus said, Lord, if it be possible. God said, it ain't possible. This is the way it's going to be done. Jesus said, well, okay, if that's the only way it can be done, that's... Now, Don saying, yeah, that's us. God said, this is the way I laid it out. Jesus says, okay, well, if that's the way you laid it out, I'm going to be obedient. Let this mind be in you. How many things has God laid out that we don't have the mind of Christ on, and we just say, it doesn't matter? This is the way I'm going to do it. In your personal life, God said, this is the way. This is the way I laid it out for you. But we say, that's not the way I want to do it. God said, I hear you, but that's not the point. The point is, this is the way I laid it out. Does this make sense? Now, since Jesus did that, therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and then gave him the name that is above every name. Jesus has the name, Yeshua has the name, that is above every name that is named. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. See, it's not a question of will every knee bow. That's not the question. The question is not will, the question is when. Because every knee will bow. We have the privilege and the honor as being members of the household of faith to bow now. Amen. But in order for us to bow now, we have to be willing to say, he is Lord and not me. He is Lord and not me. Which reminds me of that statement he made to Peter. He said, Peter, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? You know, some say Jeremiah, some say John the Baptist, you know. Some say Elijah, one of the prophets. Jesus said, but who do you say? He said, thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. Jesus said, blessed art thou, Simon, Bar-Jonah, flesh and blood has not revealed this. And now I say unto you, watch this, thou art, who did he say it was? Peter. Well, he started Simon Bar-Jonah. He ended up Peter. So here too, God changes Peter's name to change his identity. When did he change his name? He changed Peter's name. He changed Simon's name when Simon got a revelation of who Jesus was. Because once you get a revelation of who Jesus is, then Jesus gives you a revelation of who you are. Let me say it again. Let me say that again. When you get a revelation of who Jesus is, then Jesus gives you a revelation of who you are. You know, there was a lot of teaching about 10, 15 years ago about teaching people who they were in Christ, who they were in Christ. Lisa, no, who they were in Christ. I want to tell you who you are in Christ, who you are in Christ, who you are in Christ, who you are in Christ. Good teaching, who you are in Christ, who you are in Christ. Good preaching, who you are in Christ. Good. Only problem was people still don't know who they are in Christ. Why not? Because they don't know who Jesus is. The only way to know who you have to have a revelation of who Jesus is. When you get a revelation of who Jesus is, then Jesus gives you a revelation of who you are. And then you find out, oh, I'm more than I thought. I'm more than I thought. I have more in me than I thought I had. See, that solves all of the identity crisis. And Peter, along with that note, now on this rock, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell won't prevail against it. Let me say it again. Who do you say I am, Peter? Simon. Thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. He said, man, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah. Flesh and blood. Didn't reveal that to you. You didn't get that by hanging out with me. You got that because the Father revealed it to you. I know you saw me walk on water. I know you saw me raise the dead. I know you saw me cleanse lepers. I know you saw me do all of that. But none of that gave you any proof of who I am. That's why people can see miracles and still not believe. People can see signs, wonders, and miracles and still not believe, and still not change, still not be convinced God is in the midst. Because none of that, that's flesh and blood stuff. That's sense evidence. But when God the Father opens your eyes and reveals to you who Jesus is, oh, that'll change you. Give you a new sense of purpose, a new sense of being. Make you as solid as a rock. Thou art Peter. I have to say this last part. And upon this rock, I, who's speaking? Okay. I will build my church. Peter, you got the revelation. But the church ain't yours, Peter. You're the first one to get the revelation, and you're the first one to hear it from my lips. But Peter, the church ain't yours. The church is mine. It is my church. You're a part, but it's my church. I will build my church. And the only church Jesus is obligated to build is his. Because just like there's a lot of false gods out there, there's a lot of churches that ain't his. They ain't his. Let me use correct English, since I'm a seminarian. They are not his. Not every church is his church. And he's only committed to build his. I will build my church. Well, if it's his church, he has the plan. He has the strategy. He's Jehovah Jireh. He can provide. I will build my church. And the gates of hell won't prevail against it. The church is mine, Jesus said. It's my church. Somebody say this. The church belongs to Jesus. I'm just a member. Let me say it again. The church belongs to Jesus. I am just a member. Now, if it's anybody else's church other than Jesus's, it won't work. Because Jesus said, I'm going to build my church. And what's interesting is you go all the way back through the Old Testament, and God talks about Jerusalem, his city, the holy city, Jerusalem. He says, I will put my name there. What made Jerusalem holy was the fact that God's name was associated with it. What makes the body of Christ holy, sanctified, powerful, impenetrable, is the fact that Jesus' name is associated with it. It's his church. Somebody say his church. It's his church. And the gates of hell can't prevail against it. So when you've got that revelation of who Jesus is, and he has revealed to you the name of God, and you know the nature, you know the character, and you know the purpose of God, let hell come out against you. It can't prevail. You're part of the church. Let me say that again. When you've got a revelation of who Jesus is, and you're walking in that relationship with the Father, let the gates of hell come out against you. They can't prevail. Just stand still and watch God fight the battle. Watch God rout the enemy. Because the church, his church, will endure. But it's his church. And I don't think we quite get that. It's his church. We're just members. His church.
Well, I trust that you enjoy.